There are 17,412 boxes in Baldur's Gate 3. That's a lot, right? One of the things that stood out to me when I first played the game was just how many boxes there are. You see them stacked in basements, scattered across cities, battlefields, camps, basically everywhere. The humble wooden crate appears in almost every location in the game, and that's according to the wiki. I couldn't stop thinking about it. From a technical perspective, it's kind of wild. Who plays all of these boxes? How did they fill them with loot? And more importantly, for some reason, exactly how many are there? Here is my attempt at an answer. First, let's precisely define what a box is. Most dictionaries agree it's a container for objects, usually rectangular, possibly with a lid, and typically made from materials like wood, cardboard, or metal. So, thinking about the containers in the game, crates match that definition perfectly. We'll count them. I'd argue chests also qualify. They serve a specific function, but still fit the description. We can separate them into their own category. I'm excluding soft containers like backpacks and pouches, which don't match the form or the materials, and also vases for the same reason. Barrels aren't rectangular, but they check every other box, and more importantly, they absolutely contribute to the feeling that the game world is overflowing with containers. So I'm including them, also in their own category. Mimics are out. The lore says they imitate chests to catch prey, but aren't really. And finally, I'm not counting anything conjured by the player through magical means or divine intervention. I'm interested in the number of objects the developers placed in the world for us to find. That's what I'm trying to measure. Next, we need to clarify how to handle branching paths. Baldur's Gate is full of choices, and not every player will see the same locations. For this analysis, I'm considering every possible version of the game world. If a player could encounter a box under some set of conditions, I'm counting it, while trying not to double count when the same space appears in multiple forms. For example, and I'm going to avoid spoilers, there's an area of the game that looks bright and cheerful until its true dark nature is revealed. If both versions contain what's clearly the same box in the same spot, I will only count it once. Now, this isn't something I could do by hand. The game is too long, and I already knew from playing it that there are simply too many boxes. So I turned to code. I downloaded the game and every modding tool I could find, including the official toolkit released by Larian and a few community-made utilities. I figured there had to be a file somewhere describing the game world, what objects go where, and how everything is placed. The game files were completely unreadable though, so the first step was unpacking the game's archives and converting the binary files inside into something I could inspect. What I got was a massive folder structure full of XML-style files, human-readable and easy to parse with code. Browsing through those folders and paying attention to names and structure, I found a subset of files that seemed to describe where items and decorations are placed. I also learned that the game organizes its world into levels, which can mean anything from the entire first act to a tiny campfire scene. I even found tables describing relationships between levels and defining reusable object templates. In total, I identified about 1,000 files that looked relevant, way too many to check manually. So I wrote a script to scan them for keywords related to containers. The idea was to find all the object templates that might represent boxes, not to count them yet, but to figure out what I should be counting. There are many different names for boxes in the game, but most of them share a few common keywords. I grouped these into the three main categories mentioned earlier: crates, chests, and barrels. For example, anything labeled trunk would be considered a crate, lockbox would fall under chests, and tank would go with the barrels. The categorization wasn't always obvious, so I reviewed dozens of 3D models to fine-tune how the script assigns each keyword. Some might still be missing, but I made sure to include everything listed on the game's wiki, plus several extras I discovered on my own. The script returned 608 object templates that could potentially be boxes. I manually checked every single one of them using the modding toolkit, inspecting the models to weed out false positives, and ended up with 438 distinct box templates. These represent all the unique kinds of box-like objects placed throughout the game. Not necessarily visually different, but at least distinct in name and purpose. While I was there, I also counted how many boxes each model shows visually. Some templates represent piles or stacks of several boxes, grouped together as a single object. For this analysis, I was interested in both levels. The template count, which tells us how many sort of interactive elements there are, and the visual count, which reflects how many boxes a player would actually see. I also flagged a few templates that showed broken or collapsed boxes, things that might look like a messy pile of planks, unless you are paying close attention. I still wanted to count them, but maybe in the wrong category later on. With that refined list of box templates, I wrote another script to count how often each one appears across the game's levels by parsing the files. This surfaced 178 levels containing at least one box. But not all of them were necessarily meaningful. Some could be test areas or technical scenes. So I started another round of manual review to figure out which ones actually count. Evaluating a level takes time. Several minutes just to load it in the toolkit, and even more to understand what it's for. So, instead of reviewing all 178, I built a heuristic to flag the most suspicious or representative cases. The idea was to identify internal use scenes that shouldn't contribute to the final box count. One level, for example, seemed to exist only for generating item thumbnails. It had boxes, but they clearly don't belong in the real world of the game. For each valid level, I also had to decide how many times its boxes should be counted. Some levels are reused as part of larger scenes. So I had to ask, are we seeing the same boxes again, or new ones placed in the same arrangement? One example is the tents used by story characters at each camp location. A few of them contain boxes. I chose to interpret that as the characters traveling with their belongings, and counted those boxes as unique, just once, but similar judgment calls had to be made in every such case. I also found duplicate levels, near identical versions of the same place, sometimes with added fire effects or other slight variations. I made sure not to count their boxes twice. Once all the filters were in place, I did the final math by combining the data. Which templates qualify as boxes? How many instances of each appear in the world? How many visual boxes each template represents? Which levels are actually playable? And how many times each level and its boxes should be counted? That gave me the final total. ...12,568 are crates, 1,145 are chests, and 3,699 are barrels. In the case of chests, the script originally found one fewer, but I added one manually, since interacting with the toy chest reveals another chest inside it. A rare case of nested containers. Anyway, that's a lot of boxes. And most of them are crates, the classic wooden kind. Even though I've been using box to refer collectively to crates, chests, and barrels, it's clear that the humble crate is the definitive container in this game. To dig up some additional and truly fascinating box-related trivia, I kept exploring other metadata, following a similar methodology. Turns out, about 39% of all boxes are interactive, while the remaining 61% are purely decorative. That means nearly 7,000 boxes in the game can be opened, moved, or thrown, a surprisingly high number. It speaks volumes about how much of the environment is actually interactive, even in its background details. Among the scenery boxes, about 6% are placed in the world already broken. Some are clearly shattered crates, others look more like abandoned piles of wood. But now we know, they used to be boxes. About 31% of all interactive boxes contain loot, and the remaining 69% are always empty. It's worth noting that even boxes set up to contain loot might appear empty in a particular playthrough. The game uses fixed rewards for key story moments, but random rolls for everything else. And sometimes those rolls give you nothing. Breaking it down by type, barrels contain loot in 29% of cases, crates in 24%, and chests in 64%. Which makes sense. Just to clarify, we are now looking at functional objects. A pile of treasure with multiple chests might be a single interactable element. So if you are comparing these numbers to earlier ones, they won't match. We are no longer counting visual boxes. So what kind of loot do we actually find? Each interactive box with something inside is linked to a treasure table, a predefined item pool that the game rolls from. I looked at the most frequently used ones for each box type. Most barrels are associated with a table that contains food, sometimes fresh, sometimes rotten. Crates tend to yield supply tools, things like rope, thieves' tools, or trap disarm toolkits. Chests, on the other hand, usually have gold, potions, scrolls, arrows, and crafting ingredients. There's actually a tie for the most common chest loot between two tables with similar item types, one with slightly more valuable versions of these. To make the comparison a bit more tangible, I picked a drop that shows up in about 1% of cases for each box type. In barrels, that's alcohol, in crates, it's arrows, and in chests, valuable gems. So, yes, if you're hoping for something fancy, of course, go for the chests. But now we have the data to back it up. Moving on, the most commonly reused object template is this barrel. It appears 1,390 times. Even though crates are more numerous overall, they come in many different visual flavors. The next three spots in the ranking all go to crate models. The most used chest shows up much further down the list in position 20, and it's the one you find by digging. As a final aside, I looked for the very first box you see as a player. There are already some during the game's opening cutscenes, but after that, the one closest to where your characters spawn is a Mind Flayer chest in the very first room, just a few steps from the start. They are to set the tone. Let this be the first of many, many boxes you'll find along your way. This whole idea took more time and effort than I'd like to admit, and that happens a lot with this channel. If you'd like to support it, I just launched a Patreon, where I'll be sharing behind the scenes from all the videos, plus the actual code for all the games and projects, including this one. A big thanks to those who already joined during the early launch on Discord. Thank you so, so much. As for the numbers in this video, I should say they probably aren't perfectly exact. Reverse engineering a game like this is tricky, and the official modding tool has almost no documentation. I did my best to be thorough, but wouldn't be surprised if something slipped through. I will update the pinned comment if anyone spots any mistakes. Either way, what started as a dumb question turned into a surprisingly educational game dev experience. Sometimes, chasing a silly idea just because you're curious is totally worth it. This was definitely one of those times. See you next time.